How many of you know what a cold finish is? It's just something that isn't fired. Many times, glaze isn't the answer, or you put the glaze on it and it's just butt ugly or something. There are things you can do. And I like the idea of giving myself more options. It doesn't have to look like you painted it. And that's the trick that I want to show you. One of my favorite products, Bare Low Luster Masonry Sealer. There's lots of brands. My very favorite one is not being sold anymore. It was called Duck's Back. But this is the next best because it isn't too shiny. If you've ever had grout, they have grout sealer. If you ever had a driveway and it's been sealed, or this concrete floor has the same stuff, it's a sealer. And we're going to use it as a medium for putting color on pots. So here's something that has been what painters call glazing, but it's not fired. This will work on either bisqueware, plaster, or high-fired pieces. And your instructions there, the important thing is, if you're going to do this technique with the masonry sealer, it needs to be sealed. If you're working on bisqueware, remember how porous this stuff is? Your paint will just soak in and it'll look like you put a poster paint on it or something. So you seal bisqueware. If you do plaster sculptures, same technique. That's where I learned it, from a guy who does it on plaster. The other thing that I use on bigger pieces, primer. We need a primer, buy a primer. It comes in white, comes in black, comes in rust, comes in hot rod matte, and you just spray your bisqueware with a primer. And it's a little bit like painting with watercolor now. If you're painting on white paper, your colors look different than if you're painting on gray paper. So if you know you want to go to darker, earthy things, start darker and earthier. And it's just spray. Now we're going to learn how to do it. This is water soluble. All you do is look at your jar of whatever product you have. How do you clean it up? Water. So I can dissolve any water soluble colorant in this and apply it to my pot. I use just acrylics. You could use ink, you can use dye, whatever you have. You just need a colorant. Iron oxide, it's a colorant. Actually, I'm going to use some of this. This is a nice red acrylic, terra sigillata. So I'm going to get a little color in here. And you can see why you need it to come up close, because otherwise you won't see a thing. And this happens to be antique bronze. This happens to be iridescent bronze. I had some burnt umber. That's what I'm after. So all I'm doing is mixing colors. It's not rocket science. See, if you think, oh, it needs a little black, put a little black in. If you need a little something else. But we haven't got the medium in it yet. This will just be paint. We want it to seal our bisqueware so it can go out in the garden if you're doing sculpture. And the clay is like terracotta from Mexico. If it sits out for a long time, it's going to dissolve. You need to seal it. So now all we've done is mixed up. And I like to test it so I don't want it to be too dark. Where's my bucket with the paper? Here we go. See, that's what it looks like. If I want it even waterier, painters will tell you it's better to put on thin coats than to go too dark and too thick. I think I may add just a little bit more liquid. tone it down just a little bit. And better. See, it's a little more watery. I have to find one of my pieces that has been sealed. This has gesso. And if you think, oh, it's kind of streaky, I don't like that color, wipe it off. Or sometimes I dab it off. You get kind of an interesting effect by dabbing. You can always put more on, and you could probably, while it's wet, get the whole thing off if it was ugly. Maybe you want to add a little blue or green or whatever you have. Sealer has to be first, and then you can paint on it. This has been sealed. This has iridescent bronze and a little blue, and that's what it looks like.
It has sealer in it too.
Yeah, so then you can pass that one around.
Can you do that with high fire also?
Yes, because I've been working almost entirely with unglazed surfaces. And if I can't get in the reduction kill, I fire it at home and it looks wimpy, then I stain it. I didn't have anything except this to use as an example. This doesn't need to be sealed because it's vitrified. It's high fire. So I don't have to do anything. But let's say I want to tone this up so it's not quite so raw looking. Where's my rag? Here's my rag. I'm going to tone down so it stays in the creases. And the other thing, see, even just that one thin coat wiped off has changed the surface of that raw clay. If it's the wrong color, guess what? I'll let this dry, put another coat on.
The fact that the paint has sealer in it is not enough. You have to seal the piece first.
Yeah. Because what happens if you have bisqueware and you don't seal it first? See how it just went glop?
Oh.
And that was a really heavy, gaudy color of red, but it's just different. It soaks in too much. Also, you're going to notice that there's a slight sheen. These are my tests from what the work I'm doing now. I'm messy. 8 to 11 red in reduction, oxidation, Orion, T2 reduction, Orion reduction, 8 to 11. What I want you to see is the top by the chain hole has been dipped in clear. Masonry sealer.
Oh, it's got a nice sheen.
It's not gaudy shiny,
yeah,
but if you can see the difference, like on the 8 to 11 tile, it just livens it up a little bit. And so often that's really all you need, is just a little bit. Those all happen to be high fired samples. If I were working on bisqueware, remember, it's gonna have to be sealed. This is still, it's still a little wet. Say I wanted to put a second color, a wash, that tones it a totally different direction. I'd let it dry, put another wash. What if it's just ugly? Rebisque it. Burn it off. Because it's sitting on the surface, you may get a little residual colorant because of whatever colorant it is, but you'll get most of it off. But I haven't had a problem. Usually what I end up doing is putting more on. This is also interesting. Can you tell right where the sealer quit? That's why we put sealer on. See how that, it just sucked it in like crazy.
Oh, I see.
Because that was the margin where there is no sealer. So I use this a lot. And I do a lot of sculpture and garden work, And if you don't want shiny glaze, remember there's things you can do. A lot of us have done iron oxide washes, and that gives nice definition of texture. But maybe when it comes out of the kiln, it's still not what you want. Don't be afraid to try something. Now, it'll almost be a joke to a lot of people who've known me a long time. Yeah.
If I don't like it, can I wash it in the water and then make it disappear?
If it's dry, guess what? It's waterproof because it's masonry sealer made it waterproof. If you want to get it off, do it before it dries.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you use this technique over glaze?
Like yes.
If something's been glazed and you don't like it,
yeah.
Maybe use a luster?
You can build up over a glazed surface. It's, again, you're like painting on different colors of watercolor paper. You need a medium to carry it. If you just take acrylic and paint over your glazed surface, it kind of looks like you just painted it. And sometimes that's fine. But if you want it a little bit washier, I find something I can carry the colorant in.
So will it dry though on a glaze?
Yeah. It's not porous, so it takes a little longer perhaps. But it'll dry. It will not want to stick very much. So you have to kind of baby it a little bit. The things with texture work the best, like that little sample that's going around, because it'll go into the nooks and crannies. So probably if I had like a really smooth porcelain pot, this would not be a particularly good solution. Yes, you could sandblast it. Now, what I was going to do, oh, here it is. Yeah, yeah. You shouldn't need to because the sealant is right in it. What I do if I have a not a high-fired piece, but a bisque piece that I've done a sculpture or maybe it's terracotta and it's outside. Oh, all my pit-fired pieces and raku, they all get treated with this stuff by itself to keep the air off of it so it won't change color. But after I have some bamboo that have been in the garden for about 10 years. So every so often I shoot it with the hose, and if it looks like it's not beating right up, I just treat it again. I just put another coat on, because eventually it does kind of poop out after a while. But especially for sculptural pieces that maybe have not been taken up to high fire, it's a little insurance policy. The only thing is you get a tiny bit of sheen. But usually that isn't a big thing. Duxbeck had no shine at all. On a raku piece, you couldn't see anything, but it's no longer made. Now, what I was gonna say, where is that, this'll do. I have something here that I fiddle-diddled around several workshops, and maybe I still don't like it. Shoe polish. Everybody that's ever been in my class says, oh no, not the shoe polish again. I use shoe polish to bring out texture. This happens to be brown. And you kind of take off the extra, because it's easier to put several coats on than to take them off. Although you can always rebisque it and get rid of it. Okay, I'm gonna come over here where you can see. It's going to hit the high places.
You need to stand in the middle, people can see.
See?
The smell.
Yeah, it smells. People will think you're shining your shoes. What the brush does is the colorant only goes on the high places. Iron oxide usually only goes in the low places. So if you have texture, you can build it up as much as you want and tone it. I had a friend who did figurative sculpture, and she could get any skin tone known on the planet with shoe polish. Just different colors. See this now, it's catching a little more. So sometimes all you need is a little shoe polish to tone it. This happens to be brown. There's cordovan, there's black, there's all these different colors. And it will accentuate your texture. If you don't like it, what do? Rebiscuit. This will definitely burn off. Okay. Oh yeah. See, that's what all of these crevices were done with. Okay. With that.
Okay.
Probably the first coat was one color, and then another one at another demonstration, and another one. Yeah, I heard a question.
What was the question?
I forgot.
Will the sealer color combo go into the crevices?
Yeah, because it's the liquid, it'll go right in. Now. Maybe I'll wash. Any questions about, one more cold finish. Gold leaf. This was a plain white box with a leaf. The leaf impression was not very visible, so I gold leafed it. Only it isn't gold leaf. This is called like autumn colors or something. It's all just variegated. And sometimes, you can pass it around, I don't need it. Sometimes what you need, maybe you've done a little something like ornaments or jewelry and it just needs a pop. And you don't want to go buy that little bottle of gold luster that costs like $25 and you have to fire it again. This is purely decorative. I mean, this is not for food, this is just a decoration. But the kit, I get it at Michael's when they have their coupon. It has all kinds of colors. I'll leave them out and you can see. Sure, just don't sneeze. See, here's the one that I use. There's silver, there's gold, there's copper. I've used them all. And the tricks with it, the first thing is you put soap on your brush.
What?
Soap?
Soap. Water or dish soap?
I just go in the bathroom with a bar of soap. Otherwise, it's almost impossible to get it out of your brush. So if you're going to paint on a decoration, first you soap your brush, then you take the adhesives, I think it's like rubber cement, but I always just bought what they sold, and you paint it right where you want it to be. And you let it dry completely. And then you take a sheet of one of those colors and you lay it on and it sticks to the adhesive because it's not double-sided. You know that, no, it's like it never, it's always sticky, whatever it is, like rubber cement. And then I take a different clean brush, like here I've done this. The piece of foil is laying on it. I just brush it in gently, because this is really thin. You'll see it when it passes around. And that will attach it to anywhere there's adhesive. If I miss a spot and I say, oh no, I meant for that to come down here. Paint some more adhesive. Let it dry. Put another sheet on. On the one you're applying the adhesive with. Different brush. I think it's in the box there. But this soft brush is so much better for getting this extra pieces off. You'll notice I'm really frugal. Someday I may need these little guys, so I just save them. There goes one. But they're so light. I mean, if you can't work in front of a fan. It just goes.
How durable is it?
It's pretty durable. It will scratch. But they also sell a sealer. So if I'm happy with this, I paint this over it and it protects it. And it's clear. You can't see us there. I think the one that comes with the product.
Okay.
I figure I'm not going to mess with it for whatever it is. I mean, this kit I've had and used for years because I'm not doing a ceiling or a picture frame. It's just little bits and pieces. But sometimes just a little zip is what you need for a piece. So that's another cold finish.
What is so cool for that?
The soap is in the bristles of the brush so that when you take it to the sink to wash it, you can get the adhesive out. Otherwise, it's just about impossible. And you throw away a good brush, because lots of times you need a real detail and you have to use a fairly good brush. So I just have a kit, and my students just borrow it when they need it, because I mean, it'll last me a lifetime. So here's the kit. The bar of soap, the brush I used to apply, and the brush off brush. So it comes in handy for certain things. And I've used all of the colors from one time or another. So we'll put the
bar of soap, and you're using a brush on it. You're just using a dry brush on the
bar. A wet soapy brush. You want sudsy suds to get into the brush. Are there any other art mediums where you always soap your brush?
Oil wax.
I don't know. I'm not a painter. But usually somebody did that because somewhere else it worked, and so they told me, and that's what I do. It really does. I mean, I've used that same brush every time because I always wash it out right away, and never, ever, ever, ever with hot water. These Japanese brushes are glued in, and the hot water, your little thingy will just come right out. So don't ever wash your brushes with hot water, but wash them. Okay, that was an extra tip. Now, any questions about the cold finish stuff? I know it's a lot. Ask them now.
Put the soapy suds on the brush, mm-hmm. Then paint adhesive, then put the gold leaf, and then what do you put over the gold leaf?
I get rid of the loose stuff with that soft brush, just to get, because you're going to find it'll stick and then there'll be little pieces flying all over.
But the adhesive makes it stick.
The adhesive makes it stick, and that little bit of brushing makes sure you're really adhering to the adhesive. And then the sealer is just to make it stronger. If it's just hanging on the wall and nobody's ever going to touch it, I don't know that you'd even need to do that. But like the lid of that box, it needs a little protection. But it has been painted and sealed. Oh, those sheets are not very expensive. A package? Oh, that's okay. That's a souvenir. I think they're like $4 for a tablet of all those sheets. I mean, it's. I don't know why it's so cheap. It's obviously not real gold.
Can you cut the gold leaf?
Oh, yeah, but it's so delicate. I think if you just look at it, Where's
it's a super thin foil.
So how do you make a design that, I know I've seen it before, but how do you make like a design that you want with the gold leaf?
You just paint the adhesive where you want it. Only where you want it. There it is.
And the rust will come off.
Yep. And the rust comes off because it has no adhesive. So you can do quite elaborate designs. And if you have to touch it up, you just touch it up. Because often when I do it, I missed a spot with the adhesive. If I get the adhesive where I don't want it, like it blobbed out, I just take my fingernail and scratch it off, because it is thin. It's not a really thick coating, so you have to be a little careful.